So, could you please state your name and the years that you attended Linda McKinley High School? How old were you in 71 and what grade were you in?
My name is John Kaplinger. I went to Linda McKinley High School from the fall of 1968 until June of 1971. When I graduated, I was 17 years old as a senior in 71.
Great. So what was your awareness of political and social turmoil that was happening in the country when you were a teen? And did any of those events that were going on at the time shape your political awareness?
Well, like most other people who actually watched the news in 1968, I was aware of the death of Dr. King. I was aware of all the other unfortunate events that were happening at that time. 1968 was the year of the conventions, which had all the riots. Both the Republican and Democratic conventions had a number of riots. People were upset over Vietnam. People were upset over racial injustice. And all those things were going on at the same time. So 68 was a banner year for tragedy. Even Robert Kennedy was assassinated in that year. So that sort of pins down when we're talking about. And in 68, I was just a child starting high school, and I went to Linda McKinley. Now, at Linda McKinley, we had about a 35% Black population. And this was new to me because although there had been a few Black people at my junior high school, which was McGuffey Junior High School at the time, it wasn't anywhere near as integrated as, say, Lynmore High School in Columbus, Ohio. So it was a new experience for me. And like I said, it was 35% Black when I started there. By my second year at Lyndon, my junior year, it was about 50% Black. And then in my senior year, we had enough of that phenomenon called white flight that the population went from 65% Black to 97% Black. Most of that population movement was in the younger years. So the senior class pretty much stayed the same, but we had fewer and fewer white people in the 10th and 11th grade years. And we had more and more Black people coming in as the white people would move out and the Black people would move in and their kids would start the school. So it was a time of extreme change and turmoil. Like I said, Dr. King had been killed in 1968. The repercussions of that really didn't get to Ohio until years later. So when I was a senior, all of the things that were happening in the movement were beginning to show up, and we had students who were becoming radicalized, both for and against civil rights. I think I'll let you ask the next question.
Okay, very good. I want to ask you just a little bit about the community itself. And this is, not to be redundant, but just to touch on some of the things that you mentioned.
Okay.
Was there tension in the community with this shift, with the shift that white flight created? Was there tension in the community and was there racial tension? I mean, and did you feel that at the school?
Okay. At that time in the community, walking the streets, there was a geographical line that was drawn, sort of a line in the sand. And if you look it up, there's a street called Hudson Street. And below Hudson Street was primary Black. And between Hudson Street and Weber Road, about a mile north, was mixed. And north of Weber Road was a very white neighborhood, almost affluent, you could say. But in between that mile and a half between Weber Road and Hudson Street was the battleground where the only battles being fought were by real estate developers and people leaving and people coming. If you wanted to walk those streets, it would be like any other big city. You might actually find somebody who wants to mug you, but it would not necessarily be something that was racially motivated. Now, if you went outside of your zone, you might get bothered because you were a white boy south of Hudson Street. You might be bothered if you were a black man north of Weber. So that was sort of the kind of thing that was going on, was a geographic partitioning as segregation. And the mixed area was where whatever turmoil was happening. But that was, as I said, in the neighborhood. Now, in the high school itself, the level of tension started my first year there. If somebody shot me with a water pistol, I'd pull out a water pistol and shoot them back. But the next year, if I shot somebody with a water pistol, I could strongly expect that they might pull out a switchblade. And again, that was across the board, black and white. Now, the last year, you weren't really sure who was carrying a gun surreptitiously. So you didn't want to shoot anybody with anything unless you, you know, you didn't want to say or do anything to get out of line because you might get shot. It is a wonder to me, looking back after all these years, that there weren't any shootings as such, but there were people carrying guns in school. There were also people carrying BB guns because they were immensely immature, and they thought they could wave a BB gun around and somebody might be cowed into backing off. So it was a mixture of very young people, and some of them were not terribly bright people. At the same time, you had people who were dedicated and working either for white power or black power. So there was turmoil that was coming out of that.
Okay, can you talk about then what kind of a student were you?
I cannot claim to have been diagnosed, but I was probably a little autistic, probably still am. I had a nearly photographic memory, so I did real well in school. The film gets a little foggy these days, but that's been 50 years ago. I studied hard. I had my own problems with school. I had my own problems with authority. And so I ended up in a class of 454 graduating seniors. I was 34th in the class with a grade point average of 3.146. Numbers like that, I don't forget, even 50 years later. There were 545 seniors and only 454 graduated. So again, it was a time and a place with some turmoil and disturbance. But I was a good student. I had all the advanced placement courses in English, and I was taking Latin, and I was taking the physics course in my senior year. So, and I was definitely college prep. And I went on from Lyndon McKinley to Ohio State, where I spent a year finding out that gliding through classes at Lyndon McKinley didn't quite prepare you for college. But I finally did graduate from college many years later, after several colleges. And I was the kind of guy in high school that no one would be surprised I got a degree in computer science. So that sort of sums me up. I was the nerd. I was the techie. I was the Trekkie. You know, everybody wants to live long and prosper. My nickname in high school was Spock. I was the Spock in a graduating class of 454 students. So that sort of sums me up.
So So can you talk about the activities that you did? You mentioned to me that you worked with books somehow. Is that correct?
Okay. I was hired by the school as sort of a summer helper, but the work actually began before the end of the year. I got paid for what I did in the summer after the school year ended, but the rest of the time I was just a book room helper. And as such, that meant that when a new student came in, I was the fellow who would take a paper slip to the room where the books were stored, and I would get out the books they needed and give them to the student in homeroom. I was also one of the people who at the end of the school year went around and collected all of the books that the teachers had collected at the end of the year. And we had a couple of rooms designated as storerooms. We'd pile those books up on tables and count them and make sure that we had all the books that belonged to Lennon McGinley. So that was, there was a lot of moving books around and a lot of carts and a lot of lifting and stacking going on when all the books are turned in at the end of the year. And that started around the time of the, in 71, that started about the time that the final exams were going on. So people were taking final exams and I was taking final exams. And when I wasn't taking final exams, I was collecting books and inventorying them. And like I said, there was some of that work that extended on into the summer and I got paid a small hourly rate to do that for the couple of weeks that that work lasted. And when all the books were accounted for, I went home. So that was that. But because I was a bookroom helper, there came a time when the police issued badges to all of the teachers and all of the custodial staff and me. And what they were little plastic badges with a little white card inside, and somebody had handwritten on it the word staff in a black magic marker. And we would clip that little staff badge to our shirts. And I had my staff badge probably 4 weeks before the end of school. So when school started shutting down, because there came a time when, let me go back. February of 1971, we had Black History Month. And that went really well. And we had some really good assemblies where there were programs that went on and we had a lot of exposure to Black history. After that time frame, things began to fall apart because there were students who were requesting things. One of the first things that happened that I recall clearly was the day that all of the American flags disappeared from all the classrooms. And shortly after that, someone had made a hint to the principal's office that all of the pictures of all the previous years, you know, we had pictures in the hallway that would have little round bubbles in them showing the pictures of all the different classmates of all the different years going back to 1927. And in 1927, the classes were white. And up until about 1965, the classes were mostly white people with maybe one or two black people sprinkled in. And the rumor went around that these pictures were no longer relevant to the history of the school and that the glass in the frames of those pictures might make an excellent weapon if they were broken up and spread around among a group of people. So those pictures disappeared into the storeroom. And I know that because one of the storerooms they used was one of my bookstore rooms. So it made it kind of difficult to climb over them and get to where the books were stored. But that kind of thing was going on. There were demands made. And where they came from, the rumor mill would not tell me.
Okay, so I'm going to stop you right there, because before we get ahead, I want to ask you about something that has to do with your early time at Linda McKinley. So can you talk about the crew of boys that you were friends with in 68 and kind of talk about your feelings about the quote militant white boys that you knew there, and also the militant black boys that you knew at Linda McKinley, and these two different groups of students, and kind of where you fit into that?
My first year at Linda McKinley, I had friends who were seniors, because those were the closest to people I could relate to. And most of them were at least a little bit nerds. And some of them were more normal people than I was. But these friends that I fell in with had a sort of a ringleader, and he was my friend. And we would go to bookstores together, and we would do things together on weekends and after school. And he would make fun of the buses that were coming back in 1968, because the buses made a terribly flatulent noise as they were revving up and coming in and braking. And he implied that that had something to do with the black students inside the bus. And we all thought that was amusing. But the more he got into that sort of thing, the less interested I was with keeping time with him. Now, in November of 1968, and before that, we were leading into the election. And being a good son of Republican parents, Nixon was the only one for me. So I went around with this fellow, and we would put up Nixon bumper stickers, sometimes in places where bumper stickers shouldn't go. We would wear our little Nixon badges. And that was just fun until Nixon was elected. And then once again, he started harping on the, you know, on the racial stuff. And I finally found somewhere else to sit at lunch, because I just wasn't interested in playing that game. To me, it seemed awfully immature, and it got worse. And I didn't have any interest in sitting with I won't name them, but I didn't want to sit with that fella. And then, of course, at the end of the year, being a senior, he graduated, he was gone. His younger brother had sort of hung around with the group, but really didn't participate. He was my age, and he was actually in my one of my science classes, but he also was kind of a hippie type, long-haired hippie type. So I wasn't. And we didn't get along very well. I mean, we didn't have arguments. We just didn't hang together. So that was pretty much the end of my relationship with that man and his younger brother and the class of friends they were hanging with. And I found other people who were more like myself to sit with at lunch. And now, one other thing about lunch at Linda McKinley. As time went on, the lunchroom itself became a contentious place. And in my junior year, they had a noon movie every day. And there was a group of nice people. A lot of them were in Bible studies groups and such like that I attended at school. And they would all go up to the noon movie as soon as the lunch period began. Now, the movie didn't start until 20 minutes in, but we would sit up there and visit, because we felt safer in the balcony getting ready to watch the movie than we did in the lunchroom, because the lunchroom, as I said, was contentious. So we didn't go to the lunchroom. We skipped lunch and we went straight to the movie, and we spent our lunch periods in that area, in the balcony, with the projection crew and the teacher who oversaw the movie projection and was in charge of keeping order in the auditorium where the movies were projected. So again, when it came to contention, I just tried to avoid it.
So when you say that the lunchroom was contentious, are you talking about generally like sort of groups that were at odds? Was it racial? And I also want to ask you about something that you said when we talked. You said that there were times when you felt threatened by Black students. And you, I remember you mentioning coming into the school and trying to get in really fast so that you wouldn't be accosted by some of the Black students who were outside. And then you said that you understood their feelings and sort of where they were coming from, but at the same time you resented it, which I thought was really interesting and very honest. So if you could talk about that.
School in the morning, when you would go to school in the morning, there would be some students hanging around the outside. Now, these were Black students, because white students hanging around with those Black students were made to feel unwelcome. And if you walked into the door, somebody might look at you and say, "Hey man, give me a quarter." That was a very common opening line. And I really did resent that, because the idea that I could be shook down at any time for a quarter, to me at that time, a quarter was a lot of money. That was my lunch money, and I didn't have any others. So I did. There were students who would hang around outside. There were also a group of students who would hang around inside. It was like two different clubs. And they were also Black students. So getting through the doors and into the school without meeting any of those people became part of the morning gauntlet. You had to run the gauntlet. So I would get to school before they did. And I would be inside the school before they were. And that way I didn't have to run the gauntlet. And then once the school got to the point where students were bustling around in the hallways, you were less likely to be accosted. Because again, there were Black students who, if they saw something like that going on, would turn to their compatriot and say, "Man, that ain't cool. You know, he's okay." And they would leave me alone. But to be involved in that in the first place, and to have the possibility that one of those students wouldn't be there who might save my behind, I just, you know, I would do anything I could to avoid confrontations. So I'd get to school a half an hour early and hang around the hallways. Or like I said, at one point, there was a Bible club that met the half hour before school started. So I'd get there early, I'd attend the Bible club, I enjoyed it. That went on for quite a while. And then that way I could avoid, because if I got there before they did, you know, they didn't want to get to school early, and I did. So that's how I avoided that kind of conflict. But again, it was a tension. When I went in through that door, I didn't know if somebody was going to shake me down for a quarter, hit me, or just ignore me as I walked by. And that perceived threat was always there. Now, maybe I was wrong, but I perceived that threat in the environment, and I avoided that threat as much as I could. Again, leaving school, you hang around a few minutes, everybody empties out, and then you can leave. If you slide out through the right door, you don't meet anybody. And those kind of strategic, tactical decisions were part of everyday life at Linden. That's where the tension came from, was trying to plan ahead and make sure that you didn't get yourself into a situation where you might be accosted. And so there was some resentment for that. But in a way, it was something that had started and it had escalated very slowly. And over time, you just got used to it. So that was the way life was.
Gotcha.
Okay.
Okay, thank you. So I want to go to 1971 and ask you, were you at the Black History Week play that took place in February of 71?
The Black History, no, because at that point, I was only making about every other assembly. I had found ways to simply duck out of assemblies because, again, that's all the students together. There would be two assemblies, and I would manage to miss both of them. And so, again, it was a, you know, it wasn't that I was trying to avoid learning something. It was I was trying to avoid situations where there were conflict. And in fact, I don't know if it's the one you're talking about or not, but there was at least one assembly where a group of white students came in and threw a whole handful of leaflets out of the balcony that rained down upon the classrooms. And then they ducked out and jumped in a running car and sped off. But they were, the leaflets that they dropped were incitement. They were basically white power type things. Are you white? Do you go to Belinda McKinley? If you answer yes to those two questions, you, and I don't remember any of the rest of it because I didn't read it that closely. It was seditious literature. I didn't appreciate it. And I did not keep a copy.
Gotcha. Okay. And that was the one that I was referring to. So thank you for specifying that. Then I want to ask you about your friendship with John Wells and how that friendship changed. And then beyond John Wells, if you had friendships with other Black students that were affected by the social unrest at the school.
Okay. John Wells was a very special case. John Wells was in the advanced placement courses all the way through, especially English, because he was brilliant, okay? And because of that, he and I made a connection in our sophomore year. We both enjoyed interacting in a way that sometimes confounded the English teacher. We had an English teacher who was teaching the advanced placement English, and sometimes she could run rings around her, and we both enjoyed doing that. Sometimes we were a little bit cruel, but he and I did that together. We talked once in a while. We didn't have a lot of in common outside of our English class, but he was friendly enough. And then I don't remember if it was that summer or the summer after, but the rumor went around that he had gone to some sort of Black Panther summer camp. When he went away, he was friendly enough, but when he came back, he was organized and he was ready to fight for his rights. And he knew exactly how to do that. And at that point, he and I really didn't have anything else to talk about. He wasn't in any of my classes anymore. And anytime you talk to him, he had a raised fist. And again, I understood where he was coming from. If I was one of the Black kids at Linda McKinley, I'd have been right alongside of him because life sucked. And it especially sucked for Black people. So, you know, again, I did not have any personal anger about what he was saying, because I had to agree with it. What I did take exception to was being made a target as part of what appeared to be political statements. And I'm on your side, leave me the heck alone. You know, what can I do to help? But even what can I do to help did not come in outside of classes. Now in our senior year, we had some classes where we would sit down and talk about what was going on. We would share, and there were Black people and white people in those classes, and people would express themselves. And I could say, yeah, I'm on your side, but I don't know what to do about it, and I'm a target. And that was frustrating, Now, when you ask about John, pretty much I knew who he was and I saw him going by and he was in events from that time onward. But the other students, there were students like George Lewis, Matthew Harris, who later ended up teaching at Ohio Dominican, Jeannie Thomas, who ended up superintendent of schools when she became Jeannie Thomas Harris, Stan Harris, who was going to be her husband even then. They were in advanced classes. I saw them all the time. I interacted with them. Stephanie, Tina. I had lots of friends who were in my classes. They were Black students. I talked to them just like I would talk to anybody else. They would express day-to-day concerns that didn't have anything to do with racial struggle. And we were kids growing up, sharing our lives. So that was fine. But at the end of the day, when some of the final racial events were happening at Lyndon, a large number of students would gather together in the music room to hide out while all this madness was going up and down the hallways. And it was a mixed bag. We had white kids, we had Black kids, we had smart kids, we had dumb kids. We were all there because we didn't want any part of what was going on. At that time, a student like Jeannie or Stephanie, who made really good grades and was in the top 10% of the class, they received some pushback for, I guess, being an Uncle Tom. They were considered to be in some way a traitor to the cause because they were learning and because they were going to school to get into college and to get a degree and to move on with their lives. So I don't know if they weren't sacrificing enough or if they weren't doing enough to please people who were run-of-the-mill average folks who couldn't get great grades, but they were my friends. And I would protect them as much as I would protect anyone else who was being attacked. I would also protect them if they were being attacked by a white supremacist. And at that time, there was one day when we had representatives of the Black Panthers in their black jean jackets, standing on one side of one street in front of the school. And on the other side, we had the American Legion of all people, all these little old fat men carrying their big American flags in holsters that were stuck to their gut. And so we had Panthers and we had the American Legion, and then we had white supremacists and we had SDS, and we just, everybody was represented, and right up the middle of the street, we had the Columbus Police Department trying to keep all these people from mixing. So there were days when I would be sitting in the chemistry room on the second floor, overlooking all this mess, saying, what is this all about? Why are all these people posturing in front of my high school? Why don't they go home and let us go back to school? Because I was trying to get into college. And again, as I found out at Ohio State, part-time student in high school in your senior year doesn't really make a good college prep program.
Okay, so thank you for that. I want to ask you, since you mentioned this, you mentioned the police. Can you talk a little bit about the level of discord that you just alluded to and your memories of the police presence at Lyndon McKinley High School? I have a quote here from when we talked before, and you said, quote, police were at every intersection of the hallway. And you mentioned that kind of started around February.
Right after February, of course, like I said, Black History Month was sort of a turning point for this. And again, part of that was the pushback by the white supremacists during Black History Month. And part of it was their continued noise making afterwards. And then there were the students who were acting in a more radical manner. And all that in February came to a point in March, April, somewhere along there. We began to go to school in the morning and people would not go to their classes. People would be milling around in the hallways and there would be unrest. You know, a classroom is full of all sorts of weapons. You can take one of those big 3-foot long pointers that the teachers use to point at the blackboard, break it in half, and you have two jagged edged weapons. You can take a yardstick and break it in half and have two jagged edged weapons. The flags had disappeared, but the flagpoles were still there. And believe it or not, a flagpole makes a serviceable spear. So people started grabbing these things out of the classroom and walking up down the hallways. They weren't doing anything, but they were threatening. There was milling around. There was refusal to obey the authority of the principal and go back to your classes and get back to classroom behavior. So when all that began to happen, the police would be called and they would come into the school. Now, I believe the first time it happened, it was in an afternoon. The police came to the school that afternoon. They deployed tear gas. Now, I have been exposed to military grade tear gas. This was weak stuff by comparison, but it was tear gas and it was not pleasant. And they deployed the tear gas in the hallways and the principal got onto the intercom system and told everybody to go home. So we went home. That happened a couple of times. Then the students came in and began milling around right after homeroom. You know, first class, the breakdown in order occurred and the police were right there and they shut down the school right away. And I think that happened a couple of times. And then they canceled school until we had our finals. So as I said, it was probably later in May because school was only closed for a couple of weeks before finals. But there was a significant breakdown somewhere March, April, May, and then they closed the schools. But when that was happening, there were gatherings of the students on the front lawn. I did not know the name of the local radio DJ because I didn't listen to his channel. It was a more progressive jazz and black music channel. But the local radio DJ would come by with a bullhorn and talk to the students. And I don't remember when, but at least a couple of times, Dr. Ross, Charles Ross from the Ohio State University Black Studies Department, he would show up. He would say things. I don't know what he was saying. All I know is what the rumor mill was saying. And it was saying everything from the idea that he was issuing pacifying tones to he was egging on the black students to hit white people.
Okay, depends on
who you were listening to.
Let me stop you for a second because I am going to get to that, but I want to go back to something else that you mentioned in May. On May 19th, most of the black students from school marched to Franklin Park to commemorate Malcolm X's birthday.
Yes.
And you were at the school, and can you describe for me what it was like at the school when most of the black students were gone on that day?
Well, okay. That day, it had been announced that it was going to be a senior cut day, that everyone was encouraged to go to this march to commemorate Malcolm X. And this was not through the official school channels, okay? Now, one person, I believe one of the Black Studies teachers at Linden had made announcements to this effect. But again, most of what we heard came, the rumor mill runs very fast. So the idea that, okay, if you want to march in this parade. We're not officially letting you go, but attendance will not be taken. Well, I showed up to school, and I was one of a very few white students who showed up at the school. Now, let me say this. None of the white supremacists showed up either. Very few of the students who were not in the advanced classes showed up. So basically, those of us who were teacher's pets, those of us who were advanced placement, those of us who were really serious students, we showed up. All of the teachers showed up, except, of course, for the teachers who were participating in the march. And so the school was basically empty. A third of the white students and most of the black students were gone. So just the few of us who were there were rattling around in the school. The bells would ring, but nobody would go to class because we weren't having classes. We just were walking around talking to our teachers. And the teachers, one of the students was there working on the yearbook. And he was on the yearbook crew. And he remarked to me that the tension couldn't be cut with a knife. Now that was the way we would refer, the tension's so thick you can cut it with a knife. It was like that every day. And a bunch of young teens in high school, there's a high level of hormones in the air. That went away. The school was just empty and echoing. And it was like a weight had been lifted being in an empty school and just the teachers running around. So the teachers were acting a little stoned from the effects. And they were running around the hallways. They had grabbed some of the water pistols that they had confiscated in years past and filled them up with water. And they were running up and down the hallway, squirting each other with water pistols. It was a different kind of insanity from the everyday insanity that we were used to. And so it was like playing hooky in school.
I see. Okay. So I want to ask you again in May, if you recall the American flag outside the school being switched to the Pan-African flag, the red, black, and green. And
at the time we called that the Black Nationalist flag.
Okay.
Now I had heard that a demand had been made, two demands. The school should be changed to Malcolm X High School instead of Lyndon McKinley High School. And the white American flag should come down and the Black Nationalist flag should be erected in its place. Now, up until that point, everything that had ever been floated, demanded, we need to have this kind of assembly. The principal had cheerfully cooperated with that because that was within his purview. But because a Columbus Public School is in fact part of the Columbus Public School system, and therefore that flagpole does not belong to the principal, he could not just change which flag was flying there. So that was where no was said. And as far as changing the name of the school, that also went to the public school system instead of to the principal. So this was where things were being requested that were not within the purview of the principal and that had to go up to the Columbus Public School System, the school superintendent. And up to this point, as I recall, the school superintendent really wasn't involved in what was going on at Lyndon McKinley. All of the unrest, all of the events that had occurred up to that time had been solely under the purview of the principal. And in fact, the local newspapers were not carrying any of the information about what was happening. The local news channels were not. But once the riots really broke out, then you'd go home and watch it on the 6 o'clock news. and you look at the 6 o'clock news and see students chasing each other in the front lawn of the school and yelling and screaming, and the camera would pan across old Charlie, who's just standing there waving at the camera because he's not involved in any of that stuff. But it would be that kind of event where you would see insanity, and then there'd be one person who just isn't taking part. He's waving at the camera. Hey, but the story did not break in public until that late in the school year of 1971.
So do you remember a specific date when, because there are classmates of yours, former classmates, who talked about actively switching the flag? And obviously it wasn't a permanent change, but it was switched at some point. I just wondered if you remembered seeing that at all.
When I do not recall, I remember the rumors saying that they want to change the flag. And everybody that I talked to was, they can't do that. this is a federal installation. They can't change the flag. We didn't know. But I don't remember a date, but I do recall, as you say, that march is well documented. That was on the 19th. And the day that everybody took off from school was still proceeding regularly. So like I said, it was about 2 weeks before the final exams in June, before we had the events break down to the point that school was canceled. And it was somewhere between that day in May and when the finals occurred, and graduation, of course, was always around the 12th, 13th, somewhere around that in June. So we had to have our finals so we could graduate.
Okay, so before you talk about the finals, though, I want to ask you then about that, a day in that time period before finals, before the school was shut down, the day leading up to that. Do you remember the police raid that happened at the school that precipitated the school being shut down? And could you talk about what you saw?
All I can remember about that is that there would be students who would refuse to go to their classrooms, and they're walking up and down the hallways and agitating for one side or the other. But there were things going on in the hallways. Students were not going to their classes. And when that occurred, then the police would show up. I would not see the police, because as soon as the principal got on the horn and said, go home, I was at the door. But when this kind of thing was happening, the police would just appear. And again, I didn't see them, but I sure could smell the tear gas. And that's all I can tell you about that part of it, because again, my mother didn't raise no fools. I was out of there.
Gotcha. Okay, then let me ask you this. Once the school was shut down, in that period between it being shut down and exams happening, can you talk about what the rest of the school year was like? And also, you can include the exam period in your answer as well.
Remember that at that time, students were turning in books. So I was working for the book system. And I would get to school early, as always, and I would be upstairs when the police would arrive. And the police would arrive and park their vans and their cars in the teacher's parking area. And then they would form up into about a platoon strength unit, maybe 36 police, something like that. You know, there'd be about eight across in four rows. Maybe more than that. But there were a lot of police who would stand to attention in a formation in the center of the school area. The school had areas that were sort of shaped like an H. And in one of those H's, the teachers would, the police would gather in the middle of that area and strike into a formation and stand a parade rest and look very sharp in their white shirts and black ties and black pants and their saucer caps. And they were very official. And they had their walkie-talkies and they had their handcuffs and they had their guns and their tear gas and their mace. But at that time, you know, they didn't show up in riot gear. They showed up in sort of dressy uniforms without the jacket. And they showed up in formation and then they would march into the school. Another thing to remember was that this was 1971. So every policeman did not have a walkie-talkie. There just weren't that many of them to go around. So the police were in groups of two or three, and the groups would each have a walkie-talkie between them, and they would go literally every floor. You know, Lyndon had three floors, and every floor, every bend of the corridor, there would be two or three policemen standing together, basically just kind of standing there like the cop on the beat and looking around. They weren't at any kind of attention or parade rest. They were just standing there watching. And I had my staff badge. All the teachers had staff badges. So as long as you had that little white cardboard badge and that little plastic sleeve with the word staff had written across it, you could walk past the police and smile and nod and just keep going. So that, you know, that's how I got to see, because I was going to every classroom collecting books. I was walking all through the school in between classes. And if you had a staff badge, you were a hall pass. Up until that point, the school had a policy that to go to the restroom or to go from one classroom to another in between classes, you had to have a big wooden slate piece of metal that had hall pass inscribed on it. You could not miss it from 50 feet away. It was 8.5 by 11. But after the police showed up, you had to have a staff badge. And if you were a student, you had to have someone with a staff badge with you in order to move as a group.
Okay, so I'm gonna interrupt you there since you mentioned the badges, and I'm gonna ask you about the arrest of Tom Brown, the vice principal, and if you could describe what you knew or what you saw with regard to his arrest during the exam period.
As I said, at the time when I did not have exams, I was going from room to room and collecting books and putting them on a cart and rolling them down to a room that was designated storage, and all the desks had been cleared and all the chairs had been moved out. Desks had been brought into that room from other classes. So it was basically a huge storage area. And all of one kind of history book would go on one table in that room. So I was free to move around because I had my staff badge. Matter of fact, I was wearing a tie because I did not want the police to think I was anything other than what I looked like, a staff. So the designated storage room was on the second floor next to a stairway that is at the southwest side of Lyndon McKinley. And at that southwest stairway, as I was walking toward that room with a couple of other of the bookroom helpers who were wearing their staff badges, we saw our vice principal being manhandled from the third floor down to the second floor where we were. He was not going quietly. He was trying to tell them that he was the vice principal of the school. And they didn't care what he was saying. He was a black man in a white shirt with a tie. And as far as they were concerned, he might as well be Nation of Islam. They were grabbing him and dragging him in. And in the course of him trying to get them to listen and trying to resist enough to get their attention, they decided that he was being too resistive and they maced him. And they and he was being hoppy hop down the stairs with his hands handcuffed behind him. And my homeroom teacher, who was a young woman named Christine Voiles, and she was probably 28, something like that. She was my homeroom teacher, and she had a class right next to there that was taking their exams, I believe. But she was there in the hallway at that time wearing her staff badge. And she ran up to the policeman and started trying to tell them that they should not arrest the school vice principal, that he was there, he was supposed to be there, and that he was doing what he was supposed to be doing, and let go. And they were not listening to her at all. So in the end, she also was handcuffed and maced, because at one point she jumped on the back of one of the policemen and tried to grab his face because she was extremely upset to see her vice principal being treated like a terrorist and being handcuffed and maced. And she thought that that needed to be addressed immediately. And they were not listening. So, as I said, she physically attacked one of the policemen. Now, in later times, the rumor mill propagated that one of the students, who at that time was in the library, which was on the third floor, had his mother show up in the office looking for her son because she had heard through some channel that there was even more awful things happening at Linden. She wanted to get there and get her son out of there. She was Black. Her son was Black. He was in the library. And as she was arguing for someone to get her son and bring him to her, she had some sort of episode, whether it was a heart attack, a stroke, I don't even know to this day, but I do know that she was in extreme distress and the vice principal decided to go get her son and bring him to her so that she could calm down. And as he ran out of the office, he left his jacket draped over the back of his office chair with his staff badge pinned to it and ran up to the third floor. And in doing so, he passed a number of policemen who saw a Black man in a short sleeved white shirt with a tie running through the hallways and heading for the third floor. And by the time he got to the third floor, he was intercepted and arrested, and they started dragging him back down, and he got maced because he did not comply immediately and to their satisfaction. And that was where I saw him hippie hopping and trying to reach with his shoulder so he could wipe his eyes because his eyes were full of mace. And if the tear gas was bad, I imagine the mace is much worse. So as
was
they
that,
were, yeah.
Was seeing that, was that traumatic?
Was that what?
Traumatic.
Well, it was to me. Because I liked Mr. Brown. He'd always been a good guy. There were jokes about how Mr. Brown would walk through the cafeteria and you would hear thunk, 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 thunk as all the kids opened their switchblades and stuck them in the bottom of the cafeteria table so that they wouldn't have anything on them in case he checked them out. And once in a while, he would take a switchblade away from a student. He'd put it on a chair and break it with his foot, and then hand them the broken switchblade back because he was not trying to escalate things. He was just trying to keep the peace. He was the cool vice principal. The other vice principal, Mr. Steele, was the one who was the hard apple in the bunch. And he was the one who meted out punishment. But Mr. Brown was the cool vice principal. I liked him. Everybody liked him. And then he was the one that the police chose to grab and handcuff and mace. So, yes, I was extremely upset to see my vice principal arrested. It didn't occur to me till later that he was my black vice principal. Therefore, of course, he was arrested and handcuffed and maced because he dared to run through the hallways without his little badge. I thought that was the stupidest thing I ever heard, because while all that was happening, both he and Mrs. Foyles made excellent cases for the police to listen to them. And they didn't.
Right. So I want to backtrack a little bit. I know that you talked about your friendship with John Wells, but I also want to ask you about other students that you were friends with. Were you friends with, or did you know Valora Washington?
Yes, Val.
And can you talk about your memories of her?
I'm afraid they're not terribly, there's not a broad range of them. I think Val was in my English class for a couple years, and she was friendly, bubbly. And if I looked at her picture right now to put the face to the name, I might be much more strongly able to tell you. There, let me throw an undercurrent in here. At the time, I was a white boy, and the idea that white boys could be in any way interested in a black girl in my own family, my own grandparents, would strongly dissuade me from such an idea. So my parents would have been cool with it, but there was enough of that undercurrent that in my mind, you know, white boys dated white girls, and black men dated black women, and never crossed. I had a friend who was a white girl, and she began dating a black man our senior year. And by dating, I mean she belonged to a religious group where she actually could not see him outside of school. So they spent a lot of time together between classes. And when I first saw them together, it was a shock. And I really didn't know how I felt about it. But she was an important enough person to me that I got over it. And if she wanted to hang around with this guy, that's her business. So I had a big education that year, right in that little area right there. But as far as Val, she was a nice girl. But since I couldn't think, I was full of hormones. I was a 17-year-old boy. I was looking at girls a lot, but you couldn't look at the black girls because you were white. Now, if that, again, it was 1971. It was Columbus, Ohio. We were very provincial in Columbus, Ohio in 1971. It was a cow town trying to be a big city.
I see. But to your best recollection, she was in your AP classes?
She was in my English classes. I don't recall if Val was in any of my math classes or anything like that. I had very small math classes because they were the maths I was taking was the most advanced in each year that the school offered.
Okay. Gotcha.
The same people in my math classes were in my Latin classes. Okay. The same people in my math classes were in the physics class. And there were black students in the physics class and in the math student class. Jeannie Harris, Stan Harris, Stephanie. I think Tina was in the physics class too. But again, they were very attractive girls. Therefore, I didn't look at them. Because it wouldn't be right.
Understood.
I was a very confused teenager.
As we all were at some point.
And I did not really begin to mature until I was about 25 and married.
Gotcha.
Like I said, probably autistic.
I want to ask you.
Yeah, go ahead.
So I want to ask you, if you have memories of Charles Ross directly. If you don't, that's fine.
The only memories I have of Charles Ross are that he was talked about a lot. He came to a few of the sanctioned assemblies that actually happened on the stage. I believe I did go to one of the first assemblies that he was there, and he spoke briefly and eloquently. But I don't have any real remembrance of the man himself. One of the things about Dr. Ross that I was always interested in, I have considered the idea that it would be worthwhile to write a book of my own about my Lyndon McKinley experience. One of the things I wanted to do was interview Dr. Ross, because I thought that that would be one of the first places to get a good, strong adult view of what was happening at the time and what and how and why he was showing up at my high school so often, because he did show up quite a bit. I remember that he was on the front lawn one day, and he was giving an unscheduled talk to students who were arranged on the front lawn. I don't know what was said, because that was one of those days when I was leaving the school as soon as possible for self-preservation reasons.
Okay. So we're gonna start wrapping up, but I wanna ask you just a couple more questions, and thank you for all of this information.
Things that I haven't touched on. Again, I understand that we've run, over an hour here of recording, but I also understand you're not gonna use everything. So if there are any other questions that you wanna dig deeper into the meat of,
no, you've gone pretty.
I can, to be honest about it. Okay.
You've gone pretty deep. So I mean, this is great. I do want to ask you
one of the things in the notes that you sent me. Let me touch on something.
Sure.
Did the students at Lyndon McKinley have PTSD afterwards? I would say that's a definite affirmative, because one of the things that we would do. We had, at first, we had the little Bible club that would meet and study Bible verses in school from 8 till 8:30 or whatever the first half hour was before homeroom began. That finally broke up because there was a fellow who showed up who wouldn't go away and who had a particularly evangelical bent, and we basically quit having meetings. But there was also the Campus Crusade for Christ that would meet in students' homes where their parents would sanction and have meetings. And some of the students had like a playroom in the house that was big enough for 30 kids to get together. And so we had Campus Crusade for Christ meetings. And I got together with those groups for a while. And the kids from Lyndon would go to those meetings and sit down and basically just zone out, because we had a chance to decompress. We were in a group of students. We weren't in the Lyndon tension that was thick enough to cut with a knife. So those students would cut loose and do kind of crazy things sometimes. Those were the ones who were going to the Campus Crusade groups, the big Christian emphasis. Other students would go out and drink. And I would go with them once in a while because I overlapped both groups. And we would get together after a nice day of rioting at Lyndon McKinley. We'd get together and pile into the back of somebody's Volkswagen. And we'd have 15 people in a Volkswagen. We'd go to Ohio State and go to a bar where we could pass for low beer, which at the time you had to be 18 to drink, and I could pass. So we'd go to Ohio State. And as we got to Ohio State, we would hear the gunfire of the police breaking up the riots because of the Vietnam War with knee knockers and rubber bullets and tear gas. So we thought it was funny because our humor was at that level of gallows humor that we'd go to school all day and have riots. And then we'd go to Ohio State to kick back and relax, and they'd have riots and chase us out. So after all those different things happening to the students at Lyndon, we had students who immediately would go into the military rather than try any other avenue of life, because they just had to do something to get away from home and from Lyndon and from everything that they've been involved in the last 3 years. We had other students who went off to college. We had students who went to college and did well. I didn't do quite so well my first year of college. It took me a while to grow up and actually learn how to study and learn how to be a good college student. But I eventually graduated. So, but that disruption and that, we would go to classes and the classes would be interrupted. And the classes would be places where there was so much tension that students had trouble studying and trouble paying attention to what we were doing in class. That entire last year was, you were a part-time student and a part-time refugee. So that environment was what I was, you know, involved in. And yeah, I had a little PTSD from it. I did a little drugs after I graduated from high school. I finally got away from that and started studying again. It was not the best time of my life, but at the same time, it was one of the most intense times of my life because all this stuff was going on and we had to deal with it.
Gotcha. Thank you for that. And I guess then in closing, I'd like to ask you, from your perspective of having experienced what you did at Lyndon in the time that you did between 68 and 71, and even, you know, things that went on after that, when you look at the current state of race and politics in the United States, and what's been happening, especially in the past, you know, year or so, what are your thoughts? Do you see parallels? Are there things that remind you? Are, you know, just what are your thoughts?
I have a lot of resentment that there are politicians out there who want to bring back Jim Crow. I have a lot of resentment that after all of the progress we've made as white people in being and preparing to become a minority, that we haven't as a group gotten smart enough yet to be nice to the people who are going to be large and in charge. White people are going to be in the minority. And we have given black people every reason to hate us. It's time to stop doing that. And we haven't stopped doing that. So yeah, I'm a little angry. I'm a little resentful because people are on the wrong side of history. And I'd like to be on the right side of history. That's basically what I see, is things going on now. There are people who are trying to take giant steps backward, and it's not going to work. I don't know how it's going to play out, but it's not going to work out for the white supremacists. And I hate the fact that in any way, shape, or form, I could be associated with them because I hate them. I don't like Nazis.
I see. Well, thank you.
Each generation knew what to do with Nazis. You kill them. Okay, so am I a militant anti-Nazi? No, because I'm not taking action on it. But sometimes I wish I could.
Understood.